Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Hope everybody had a really great week. It was a blessing to have Preston with us last Shabbat and his teaching. And we look forward to having him back again, and he will be at Sukkot with us this year. So we are a blessed people, are we not?
Amen.
Amen. Today, I have chosen to speak on the subject of worship again. And the reason that I've chosen to speak on that is not so much for this congregation, because we do worship and I have taught you, but I want to reach those people who have not heard our teaching on worship, and just have them examine the things that I am saying today, the things that Yahweh is speaking to them about. And so I ask you to do this. Open your scriptures and follow along so that you will know what I'm talking about as we go through the teaching on worship. As I said, I'm going to speak about worship, but before I go to worship, I want to talk to you for just a moment about praise. And I'm going to be talking more about this, but as you know, in most circles, you will hear the term praise and worship. And what they do is combine those two, praise and worship. It's not like it's praise and worship, two different things. It's like it's one and the same, praise and worship. So I want to talk about that. So what is praise, and what constitutes praise? What does it mean to praise? Not according to me, but according to the Torah. What does the Torah tell us about praise? Well, we read from Judges 11 today, but look at Judges chapter 5, verse 3. Hear, O ye kings, give ear. In other words, what?
Listen.
Listen to who?
Yahweh.
Not listen to me.
Listen to Yahweh.
Listen to Yahweh, what he has to say. O ye princes, I will sing unto Yahweh. I will sing praise to Yahweh, the Elohim of Israel. Praise. Very interesting Hebrew word. Yodah. Made of a yod, a dalet, and a hey. And the word yodah is an action word. That doesn't seem to be too surprising, since Hebrew is about what you do. But it means to throw. And a concrete word meaning the hand. So if we combine those, it means to throw the hand, or to throw out the hand, or to raise the hand in praise or confession. So throwing the hands up, throwing the hands out, however you want to look at it, but it is what? Is it worship?
No. Praise.
What is it? It is praise. So I want you to get a clear picture. Worship then is praise, throwing out the hands or throwing up the hands. So let's look a little further, but look at the word. It says, or confession. We're going to get into that a little bit. Hebrews, the second chapter, verse 12, says, I will declare your name to my brothers in the midst of the assembly. I will do what? Sing praises to you. How was Yahweh praised in these verses? What did we just read? How were they praising
him?
Lifting their hands and what?
Singing.
Using their voices to sing praises to Yahweh. So what is one of the ways to praise?
Singing.
Lifting
hands.
Another is raising your hands, or doing both. That's praise. So I'm just trying to give you a clear picture of what praise is all about. By lifting the voice in song and by singing to Him praises. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 15. By Him let us offer the sacrifice of praise to Eloah continually. That is the fruit of our lips confessing His name. Now, a few moments ago, I showed you where it's talking about raising the hands or confessing. So what are you confessing?
His name.
His name. If I'm going to confess His name, then I have to confess His name. I'm not talking about slang. I'm not talking about nicknames. I'm not talking about titles. I'm talking about His name. To confess His name, because that's important to Him. Don't you get the picture here that Yahweh is telling us that His name is important?
Yes.
I think He makes that abundantly clear. But He does say that one thing is even more important than His name. What is it? Does anybody know? His Word.
Yeah.
His Word is more important than His name. How is Eloah praised in this verse? Look at it again. By the fruit of our lips, by confessing His name. So we're praising His name. We're uplifting His name. We're talking about the great things that He has done for us, and we're praising Him accordingly. This is what it's talking about. I don't know what happened there. By confessing His name is the answer. Psalm 149, verse 3. Let them praise His name in the dance. How are they praising Him?
Dancing.
By dancing. Let them sing praises to Him. Dancing and singing. With the tremble and the harp. By music. 150 verse 4. Praise Him with the timbrel and the dance. Praise Him with stringed instruments and pipes. Here again, praising Him with music. 150 verse 5, praise Him on the sounding cymbals. Praise Him with the resounding cymbals. Let everything that breathes praise Yahweh, praise Yahweh. So what have we learned so far as what is praise?
It's with our hands, confessing with our mouth, singing, instruments.
Okay. Isn't that how they do praise in, let's say, in a church service? Is that the way they praise? Yeah, they sing. They raise their hands.
They don't dance.
They proclaim a nickname. But that is praise. And this is the picture that I want everyone to get. We're talking still about what is praise. How is He praised? We covered all of those. Songs and music. Praise was always, always, always done with music, song, and confession. Music, song, and confession. Raising the hands. As you can see, praise was done while sitting, while standing, and while dancing. So what did we do a few moments ago here?
We were praising Him.
Okay, so we don't call it here praise and worship.
No.
Praise is praise. And that's what we've done so far. And worship is worship. Did we do worship?
Yes.
We did worship. So I want to talk about that primarily today. Praise has the function of ushering the presence of Yahweh into our midst. So why do we praise Him?
To bring Him into our congregation.
It's an invitation for Him to come and join us.
Exactly.
To come and be in our midst. Psalm 22 verse 3. But you are holy, O you that inhabit the praise of Israel. Now, if I were reading the typical English translation in the Bible, what would it say? Using the vernacular of the church today, God inhabits the praises of his people. Now that's where they stop. Mm-hmm. Is everybody aware of that?
Yeah.
You will hear sermon after sermon, teaching after teaching, when they say, God inhabits the praises of his people. But they never tell you the next part. Of his people,
Israel.
So if you are not Israel, you are not his people. And he does not inhabit the praises of those who say they have replaced Israel.
That's a fact.
You must be Israel. Now notice I didn't say you have to be a Jew. I said Israel, of which the Jewish people are most certainly a part of Israel, are they not? So we're not excluding anybody here. Except those that say, we're not Israel, we've replaced Israel. We're the church, we're not Israel. Well, then he doesn't inhabit your praise. And if that's the case, why waste your time? Listen, I didn't say this. Let's say it again. But you are holy, set apart. O you that inhabit the praise of Israel. I don't see where he says it inhabits the praises of the church, do you? And I don't mean to be negative or judgmental. I'm just simply telling you that that's what the Torah says. That's what his word says.
He's already
now that we've praised him, we've invited him in to our midst, what do we do with him? He has graciously heard our praises. He has seen our dancing. He's seen us raise our hands. He's seen us as we proclaimed his name, as we sang songs to him, as we played music. So he comes in the door and he stands there, and what are we going to do with him now? We have a connection to our Creator through our praise. This is what he means when he says, I will inhabit the praises of my people Israel. You are praising him in order to establish a connection with him. What is our connection to the Creator according to his word? Let's look. Revelation 1, verse 4 and following. John to the seven congregations which are in Asia. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is coming, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne. Even from Yahshua the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood and made us kings and priests to Elohim and his Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. So, what is the connection we have with him? What is the connection that he's established to be kings and priests? This is the connection we have with him, because he has said through the blood, through our restoration, through our deliverance, that he wants us to be kings and priests. Now, look at the word king. A mem, a lamed, and a kof. King or council. This word in Hebrew is melech. It is an action which means to reign. The action word here means to reign. And an abstract which means to walk. And if we look at the breakdown of the words up here, you see the mem and the lamed, and you see the kuf at the end. Well, if you look at the one I have here, means to walk among people. To walk among people. Priest. How do we define a priest Hebraically? Well, We see it up there again, a kof, and we have a hey, and we have a nun. The base which supports the people. Notice the letters, the kof, which means the palm of the hand. And hey, which means behold, the little picture of the man with his hands up, behold. And the nun, which means what?
Seed.
The seed, okay? Behold the palm containing the seed. Behold the palm containing the seed. Let's look. Our primary connection to our Creator then is that of a priest. We are priests because He has made us a kingdom of priests. And He also includes kings. Don't get caught up though in the word kings. He has made you kings and priests. Just examine verse 5 again very carefully. So let's look at verse 5 again. Even from Yahshua, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. So He's made you a priest and a king, but you're a little K. You're a little king. Yahshua is still over you. So don't get caught up in a prideful attitude about being the king. I will remind you this way. You're not the king of kings.
That's right.
But He sees you as a king and a priest, and He's blessed you that way, and He's trusted you with that. And how wonderful and awesome is that? To know that you are before Him as a king and a priest. But as a priest, it isn't just to praise Him. It is also to worship Him and to teach others about worship. So we're going to be priests and kings. What is our primary function in the position of a priest and a king? Can you see okay? Let's look. Exodus chapter 28, verse 41. You shall clothe Aaron, your brother, with them, and his sons with him, and you shall anoint them, and you shall consecrate them, and you shall sanctify them, so that they may minister to me in the priest's office. Now, I want you to notice one of the things I think that a lot of people fail to do is when we're reading a verse of Scripture such as Exodus 28:41, we read through that without really examining what He's telling us here. Because there are some things that He is relating to us that has to be before you can occupy the office of a priest. You can't just say, I'm a priest. You can't proclaim yourself to be a priest. There are some requirements here. And so let's take a look. The primary function is to minister to Yahweh. Do you remember that when Aaron and his sons and Moshe were entering into the ministry of a priest, that Yahweh said that the job of the priest is to minister for the people to him and from him to the people. And so it's kind of a two-way street that you're doing here. The most important part of this ministry that the priest has is to do what?
Worship.
To worship. That priest praises Yahweh, invites him into his presence, and once he's in his presence, he worships him. This is a primary thing for the priest to do. To minister before Yahweh, the Kohen, which is Aaron and his descendants, entered the Holy of Holies. How many remember that? Now we know he went in and he put the blood on the mercy seat. But how many know that while he's in there he worships? Beloved people, you don't go before Yahweh and not worship Him. You're just not going to do that. You don't stop at praise. You worship Him once He's there and in your presence. One of the things that is required is that you be anointed. That's in the verse that we just read, if you want to go back and look at it. You have to be anointed. That is a symbol of the Ruach HaKodesh being in your life. Anointed of the Ruach HaKodesh. Number two, it says you have to be consecrated. Consecrated here means to be filled with the Ruach. There has to be a filling of the Torah in you. How many know the Ruach is the Torah? And the Torah is the Ruach. So, filled with the Ruach. Number three, it also says you have to be sanctified. Sanctified means clean, set apart, undefiled. Now let me ask you something here, kind of off the track for just a moment. But if I eat something that Yahweh says is unclean, can I say that I'm clean?
No.
I just ate something unclean, and I can't profess that I'm clean. And so, beloved, it does involve the laws of kashrut. You have to eat what is food for you and not eat what is not food for you. That is just one of the things you have to do. Can you imagine the priest as he's about to go in and represent the people before a holy Yahweh? And he says, well, give me a few minutes. I've got to have a ham steak before I go in. It's not going to work because of what?
It's unclean.
Renders him unclean. And he can't minister. Their worship had to match the pattern. I want to drive that home, and I'm going to mention it over and over and over to you today. How many know that when Yahweh talked to Moshe about the tabernacle, how did he instruct Moshe to put the tabernacle together?
After the pattern that he would show him.
And how many would believe me if I told you that all of the things they did were after a pattern?
Yeah.
Every single thing, not just the tabernacle, but everything in the tabernacle and everything that they did as far as praise and worship went. It was according to a pattern. And Yahweh shows us the pattern. I showed you his pattern for praise. And now we're going to talk about worship here. Luke chapter 11 verse 2 says, and he said to them, when you pray, say, Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, as in heaven, so also on the earth. What does that mean? Somebody help me. What did he just say there? Follow the pattern. As it is in heaven, so shall it be on the earth. I'm going to show you a pattern, and you follow it. You don't add to it, and you don't take away from it. You follow the pattern. Amen?
Amen.
Not really that hard to understand. From our Messiah's prayer, we see that he calls for the Father's will for the things of earth should match the pattern in heaven. Isn't that what he just said? So what do we have to have? We have to have a pattern. If we're going to know how to worship, we don't just formulate it in our mind. We don't make up our mind how we're going to worship. We don't decide how we're going to do it. We're going to do it the way he says to do it. Everybody with me on that? But how is it done today?
According to men.
According to men. They just decide what they want to call worship, and that's what it has to be. And they've taught it for 100 years or 200 years, so it has to be right. No, it's still wrong. I don't care if you've taught it for 1,000 years. If it doesn't match the pattern, beloved people, it's wrong. You're not doing it according to the pattern. Question. Does the worship of the churches today match the pattern? We don't know right now, but we'll see in a few minutes. And the answer is, as you said, no. Does the worship we see, even among the Messianic or Hebrew roots group, match the pattern?
No.
No. Very few people are worshiping. Most of them are praising, but that's as far as they ever get. Am I right or am I wrong?
You're right.
Is our worship pleasing to him? Or does he reject our worship as foreign, as strange fire? Remember Abihu and Nadab, who brought strange fire? Well, anything that's unacceptable to him, that's not according to the pattern, is strange fire. And so if you're making up your own mind how you're going to worship him, and you're offering that to him, I assure you he's rejecting it. Now that's hard.
But it's true.
But it's a wake-up call for the congregations of the Most High to learn how to worship. I think it's really important. Most all of us have seen and participated in strange worship, haven't we?
Yes, we have.
We combined two very different functions and called it praise and worship. So here's how it goes. I come into the service, and the music is very upbeat, and I'm up waving my arms and dancing around and doing these things. And then the music slows down, and all of a sudden, I become most holy.
Yeah.
I've got my hands up, and I'm doing all these things, and now I'm worshiping. Is that the pattern?
No.
That is not the pattern. I'm not making fun of anyone. I'm just trying to wake people up here. But is this according to the pattern seen in the heavens?
No.
Now, right now, the people out there haven't seen the pattern. They haven't seen it in the scriptures, but we're getting there. Here is another verse which shows the importance of following the pattern of the one in heaven. So let's look. Matthew 18:18. Read it carefully. Truly I say to you, whatever you shall bind on earth shall occur, having been bound in heaven, and whatever you shall loose on earth shall occur, having been loosed in heaven. What did he just say?
The pattern is in heaven.
The pattern is in heaven. Whatever is bound in heaven is bound on the earth. And whatever is loosed in heaven is loosed on the earth. That's the pattern. Everybody see that?
Yep.
What does heavenly worship then look like? That's the question. What is the pattern? Look at Revelation chapter 4, verse 10. The 24 elders fell down before the one sitting on the throne, and they worshiped him who lives forever and ever, and threw their crowns before the throne, saying. What did they do when they went into his presence?
They fell down.
They didn't sit on their blessed assurance, and they didn't stand up. They fell on their faces before him. Now I'm going to tell you, the word worship here is a very important word. And in Hebrew, we're going to talk about it in just a moment. But what I want you to see out of that verse is the 24 elders, when they are in the presence of the Almighty, they fall on their face. And you find this repeated over and over and over in Scripture. I'll give you an example. When Yochanan the Beloved came into the presence of Yahweh, he fell on his face as though dead.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't sit and he didn't stand. Worshipped. There's the word I want you to see. And I want you to memorize that word. That is a really important word. Shachah. It means what? Look at it up here. An action word meaning to bow. The meaning of shachah is to pay homage to another one by bowing or getting on the knees with the face to the ground. That is worship. Worship is not standing up, playing music, waving your hands about, speaking in tongues, or whatever it is that you want to do. That's praise, but it is not worship. And I want everybody to see that. So what does it mean to pay homage to another one by bowing or getting on the knees with the face to the ground? That is the pattern. And we're going to see it over and over. Revelation 7:11. All the angels stood around the throne and the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell before the throne on their faces and worshiped Elohim. Where are these individuals?
Before the throne. They're in heaven.
They're in heaven before the throne in the presence of Yahweh. Worship is the very same Hebrew word. Shachah means worship. So anytime you see worship, it's that word. Anytime you see the Hebrew word, it means worship. Notice their position before Yahweh. They were on their faces before Him. Again, if you're sitting on your behind or you're standing up, that is not according to the pattern. And He rejects that kind of worship. We were created for worship and commanded to worship. Everybody understand that? Get that? Isaiah 66:23. And it will be. Notice. Somebody help me here. If Yahweh says to you, and it will be, do you think it will be?
Absolutely.
From one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, all flesh will come to Shachah, worship before me, says Yahweh. Anybody see a problem that we, a failure on our part as a congregation here?
We don't worship on the new moon.
We don't get on our faces at Rosh Kodesh. I just discovered that. We need to repent, and at Rosh Kodesh, worship needs to be a part of Rosh Kodesh. We've fallen short there. But I want to read it again. And it will be. That means He says this is it. This is what you are going to do. From one new moon to another and one Sabbath to another, all flesh will come and worship before me. So, we're still learning. We're still growing. And I'm sure there's a lot of things that we need to allow to get into our hearts. According to this verse, what is the minimum times of worship?
From one new moon to the next, to every Sabbath, from Sabbath to Sabbath.
On each new moon, each Rosh Kodesh, and on every Sabbath. Now, we as a congregation, we have been for about the last year now, been worshiping, getting on our face before Him, and worshiping according to the pattern that He has given us. Amen?
Amen.
Very few people, though, match the pattern of worship shown us in the Scriptures. I've heard a number of excuses, as you have, given to avoid His command to worship, to Shachah. Bow with your face to the ground. One of them that I heard was this. Well, the only time you're supposed to get on your face is when the Shekinah is there. What? The Shekinah is there. Well, the last time I examined Scripture, if you're a child of Elohim, you're His temple. And His Shekinah is in you. And so His presence is always with you. And so that's just an excuse because you don't want to worship. What you want to do is come up with all kind of reasons not to worship instead of just saying, I'm going to follow the pattern. I'm going to be obedient. It is rebellion. And we need to stop rebelling against it. Second one is, it looked like a Muslim. You know, the Muslims get on their face five times a day. So this is an excuse not to worship. Because you might look like a Muslim. They get on their face five times before a false god. And you, my beloved people, won't get on your face before the holy Yahweh. Instead of that, you'll say, well, I look like a Muslim. No, you will look like an obedient servant of the Most High, who is on his face worshiping Yahweh. Where do you think the Muslims got the idea to get on their face? Another one. You should prostrate yourself only when Yah's presence is there. I talked about that already. He is with you. His presence is there. If his presence isn't there, there's a serious problem in your relationship. And you really need to examine it. So don't tell me that I only worship when he's present. He is present. People will mock me. Well, they'll make fun of me if I do that. They see me on my face, they'll make fun of me.
Let them make fun of me.
That's exactly right. Which would you rather do? Would you rather be rebellious against Yahweh or worry about whether somebody's going to make fun of you? I'll look like a holy roller.
I don't think so.
I mean?
No, that's not true.
If I get down the floor, I'm going to look like a holy roller.
No.
They roll on the ground.
They roll around the hall and scream and carry on. Yeah.
You are going to look holy.
I don't know if that's it or not, or I'll just look humble.
You'll look holy. You have to be separate.
Well, yes.
Come out from among them and be separate. And that's what we have to do. If Yahweh entered the place where you worship, what would you do?
On my face.
I want to share this with you, just a little sidebar. There was an old farmer who lived way out in a remote area and didn't hardly ever go into the city. But one day he was in the city and he's wearing his overalls and his straw hat. And he went to this church because he heard the music playing. And he went down and sat down in the church so that he could listen to the people and listen to the music and all of that. And everybody was staring at him because of wearing his overalls. And he was just a farmer. And the pastor caught him after the service out in front of the church. And he said to him, I suggest to you, sir, before you come back to a service here, that you ask God about proper attire when you worship in this church. And so the farmer said, okay. So a couple of weeks later, the farmer comes back to the church, goes in and sits down in his overalls, just like he did before, listens to the service, goes out after the service, and the pastor goes up and said, excuse me. He said, I thought I asked you, before you came back in this church to worship, that you would ask God about the proper attire to wear. He said, did you do that? And the farmer said, I certainly did. And he said, well, what did God tell you? He said, God told me he didn't have a clue because he's never been in this church. So we need to be careful, don't we? Would you sit in your chair to worship him after knowing the pattern?
No.
Would you stand to your feet, raise your hands, and wave them in the air?
Not to worship.
Is that the way you'd worship? Does it match the pattern?
No.
No. Would you clap your hands and shout hallelujah?
That's praise.
We're still talking about praise, aren't we? Mm-hmm. We haven't moved from praise to worship. Would you fall to the floor with your face to the ground and say, holy, holy, holy is Yahweh Almighty?
Amen.
That's worship. Isn't it?
Yes.
That's the pattern shown in the heavenlies. I assure you it would be the last option. And I will say this, even if you didn't want to. I'm telling you, if he came through that door today and walked into this assembly, you'd fall on your face whether you want to or not.
Exactly.
You know, we have these really macho people who say, nope, I wouldn't get on my face before him. I don't even believe in him.
Well,
doesn't matter whether you believe in him or not, I assure you, you get on your face.
And every knee shall bow.
For it is written, as I live, says the Master, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue confess to Eloah. So yes, everyone is going to do that. What is seen in most congregations today looks good on the surface. Would everybody agree with that? I'm telling you, when the music slows down and we stand there and do this, or whatever it is we do, or sit in our chair, we look so holy. We look like we're so worshiping. But it doesn't match the pattern. And we're still in the mode of praising. We have not moved from praise to worship. We're inviting him in. He comes in. And then what do you do with him? Jeremiah 29:13 says, "And you shall seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart." How many know that has to do with worship? Look carefully at the verse. What does it really mean when it says, "If you seek me"? Is Yahweh playing hide and seek with his people? I'm going to hide someplace and you come seek me. And if you seek me with all your heart, you'll find me. Is that what he's doing?
No.
How many know he's not into playing games?
That's right.
Seek. It is a bet, a oof, and a shin. A primitive root word, which means to search out by any method, but look, specifically in worship or prayer. So when he says, "If you seek me with all of your heart," what is he really saying?
You will worship me with all of your heart.
If you worship me with all of your heart, you will find me. Let's take this meaning and revise the text a little bit. "And you shall worship me and find me when you follow me with all of your heart." Does anybody in this room believe that Yahshua was a Baptist?
No.
Or a Methodist?
No.
Or Catholic? He was Hebrew, wasn't he?
He is Hebrew.
He is. Praise, which was done in the outer court, has now made its way into the Holy of Holies and has been refashioned and renamed praise and worship. So the thing that used to be done in the outer courts that was praise and invited Yahweh in to the Holy of Holies, and then they went into the Holy of Holies and worshiped him, that's now become the same thing. It does not match the pattern of the Torah, therefore it is strange fire. So what am I saying? Just about all thing that is called worship today is strange fire, and Yahweh rejects it. That's what the word says. It isn't because I said it. Proper worship is commanded in Scripture. John 4:23, "But the hour is coming, and now is, when true worshipers, shall worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father seeks such to worship him. Elohim is a spirit, and they who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth." True worshipers. What are the people who today are lifting their hands, sitting on their rear? They're not true worshipers.
They're only crazy.
The hour is here. The hour is now. Learn to be a true worshiper. He is seeking those who are willing to follow the pattern, to prostrate before him, to kneel or to bow in worship before him. Psalm 29:2. "Give to Yahweh the glory due his name. Worship Yahweh in the beauty of holiness." So how do we glorify him? We worship him. There's that Hebrew word again. Shekhah. Worship him on your face because you are holy. You are set apart for worship. You are a priest who bows in the Holy of Holies. He dwells in you. You are his temple. Psalm 95, verse 6 and following. "Oh, come, let us worship." And what? "Bow down. Let us kneel before Yahweh our Maker." For he is our Elohim, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your heart, as in the day of strife, as in the day of testing in the wilderness. How do these verses tell us to worship?
Bow down,
kneel down. Do you see sit down or stand up or lift your hands there?
No.
Kneel, bow down. This is worship. What is that Hebrew word again?
Shachar.
Amen. Oh yeah. Shachar. Bow down. Let's look at some more proof texts. We'll go through it quickly. How much time? Are we running out? Okay. Psalm 99, verse 5. Praise Yahweh our Elohim and worship at his footstool. He is holy. How am I going to worship at his footstool if I'm standing up?
You can't. You'll be above it.
How am I going to worship at his footstool? What is his footstool anyway?
The earth.
The earth is his footstool. So how am I going to do it? With my face to the earth. Does everybody see that? Open the door, invite him in. When he is in Shekhah, fall on your face before him. Don't harden your heart. Don't keep making excuses. Worship according to the pattern seen in heaven. Be pleasing to him, and your worship be acceptable. Isaiah 45:23. I have sworn by myself, the word has gone out of my mouth in righteousness and shall not return. Look, that to me every knee shall bow, every tongue shall swear. Every knee shall do what?
Bow.
Not stand up. Not sit down. Bow.
That corresponds to Romans 14:11.
Every knee will bow and every tongue will confess his name. Why not begin now?
Yes.
Why not say, I'm guilty. I haven't been following the pattern. I was sincere. I thought what I was doing was worship. But now, Father, I see from the pattern that what I've been doing all of these years is not really worship. And let me not make excuses, but let me say, I'm going to get on my face before you today and worship you according to the pattern. The way you have said to do it. What's wrong with that? What is so difficult about that? How did Yahshua worship the Father? Then there is a good question. I have heard all of my Christian life, when I was a pastor in a Southern Baptist church and other churches that I pastored, when people would talk about worship, and they made up their own minds how to worship, right? But how did Yahshua worship the Father?
He went off to himself and knelt.
Let's look. Matthew 26:39.
And
he went a little further and what?
Fell on his face.
And prayed, saying, O my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. Yeshua didn't say, well, I'm going to sit here on a rock and I'm going to worship him. Or I'm going to stand up and put my arms up in the air and look really holy and put my head back and close my eyes and worship him. No. He fell on his face. Amen? He did no different than the way he commanded us. If it is good enough for our Messiah, it is certainly good enough for us. Isn't it?
Absolutely.
If he falls on his face to worship the Father, then what ought we to be doing?
Following the pattern.
Following the pattern. Finally, let's look at just a few more verses that reveal true worship. I don't know how far I have to go to get people to understand what it means to worship. But I'm going to give you a few more. Revelation 7:9-10, After these things I looked, and lo, a great multitude which no man could number, out of all the nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palms in their hands. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our Elohim, sitting on the throne, to the Lamb. Now, so far they're standing, aren't they?
Yeah.
Okay. And all the angels stood around the throne, and the elders, and the four living creatures, and they
fell
before the throne on their faces and worshipped Elohim. Yes, they were standing there initially, but when it comes time to worship, they're not standing there. They're falling on their face before it, saying, Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to Elohim forever and ever. So you see, worship is not the time you get on your face and ask Him for things.
No.
It's a time you get on your face and you worship Him for who He is and what He has done for you and me.
Acknowledge Him.
Totally acknowledging Him. And the seventh angel sounded. This is Revelation 11:15. And there were great voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of Yahweh and of His Messiah, and He will reign forever and ever. And the 24 elders sitting before Elohim on their thrones, they're sitting at this point, but look, fell on their faces and worshipped Elohim. So they were sitting, but they didn't remain sitting. They fell on their faces. Everybody sees that, right? Revelation 11:17, saying, we thank you, O Yahweh, Elohim Almighty, who are and who was and who is coming, because you took your great power and reigned. Revelation 19:4. What I'm showing you here over and over is the pattern in the heavenlies. And the 24 elders and the four living creatures, what?
Fell down
and worshipped Elohim sitting on the throne saying, Amen, Hallelujah. These verses clearly show the pattern of worship. Always what? Kneeling, bowing with their faces to the ground. It's over and over and over. Why is it that people refuse to do it?
Because they don't know about it.
Why do they continue to rebel? Well, after this teaching today, you're going to have no excuse. I pointed it out over and over in the Torah. Now, will we continue to offend Yahweh with counterfeit worship? Or will we follow the pattern shown us in the Scriptures? It is a choice. Before you, I place choices, blessings and curses, life and death. And He says what?
Choose life.
Choose life. Make the right choice. Amen?